Hi, this is Electronics. In this video, I will build a Bluetooth speaker using salvaged and brand new parts. Before the video starts, be sure to subscribe and press the bell to get notified when a new video is uploaded. For this build, I was thinking to use a stereo Bluetooth amplifier module. On one channel there would be a subwoofer, on the other channel a tweeter and a full range speaker would be used. To build this speaker, I will use the salvaged subwoofer from the Watson 5.1 audio system. You can find a link to the teardown video of this system in the description. The smaller full range speaker will be the AIMA 2.75-inch neodymium speaker from AliExpress. The third speaker will be a salvaged tweeter from a Philips speaker. The Bluetooth receiver and amplifier board will be the Sanwoo Bluetooth amplifier, also from AliExpress. You can find a link to the review video in the description. Let's start with the design of the speaker. The first step is to measure the speakers with the Dayton Audio DAC version 3, so the enclosure can be designed according to the speaker parameters to achieve the best sound quality, frequency range and response. If you want to see the whole process of measuring a speaker, you can check out my DAC version 3 review video in the description. Here are the results, these parameters will be used to design the enclosure. There is no need to measure the tweeter because it has already a closed structure. The second step is to calculate the enclosure size and the transmission line or reflex tube size using the WinISD freeware software. In the driver editor, the speaker parameters must be entered. When I measure a speaker with the DACs, I usually do 3 measurements and I enter the average of the measured parameters. The WinISD automatically calculates the rest of the missing parameters and now the enclosure can be designed. I won't go in details on how to design a good enclosure in this video. Let me know in the comments if you want me to do a dedicated video. After tweaking a lot of settings, the final enclosure size and transmission line data for the subwoofer were ready. The subwoofer chamber size is 4300 cubic centimeter and the tuning frequency is 60 Hz. The vent size is 14 by 1 cm and the length is about 25 cm. With these settings, the subwoofer can go lower than 50 Hz at minus 3 dB according to the WinISD. At the signal menu, I've set the system input power to 5 watts because the Sanwoo Bluetooth amplifier output power is around that value. At the advanced menu, I've checked the simulate voice coil inductance, this way the curve looks more realistic. I've also imported the AIMA full range speakers data and it will be in a 1344 cubic centimeter closed chamber with a tuning frequency of 133.4 Hz. Going back to the subwoofer, if I will place polyfill in the subwoofer chamber, it will make the space virtually bigger and this will help to get to even lower frequencies according to the WinISD. Now that the size values are given, I've come up with the blueprint of the speaker enclosure. On the left there is the subwoofer, in the middle the tweeter will be placed and it will be sealed. On the right, in a separate chamber, the full range speaker will be placed with all the electronic stuff. The size of the subwoofer chamber will be 14 by 14 by 22 cm, which equals 4312 cubic cm. The size of the full range chamber will be 8 by 12 by 14 cm, which equals 1344 cubic cm. When the blueprint was ready, I started to cut the material for the speaker cabinet. The material used is strip parquet. This material was a leftover from a room restoration and it is really strong and solid material, just perfect for a speaker cabinet. I recommend measuring twice before cutting and check the right angle so everything can fit well. You can easily check the right angle by measuring the rectangle diagonally in both ways or you can use a sheet of copy paper. Also try to get similar clamps, these can hold the material really good while cutting it. The speaker cabinet started to take shape. I've asked my work colleague to help out with the rounded edges, which came out nice. These rounded edges can help to minimize the diffraction and also the diameter of the vent remains the same around the corner. I've just placed all the parts to their place to see if everything fits well before using the glue. The wood glue is really good to fix together the speaker cabinet parts. If you have the possibility, just clamp them together for a few hours and it will make a strong bond. If you can't reach some points with the glue, just use a paintbrush. The front panel pieces are cut and the mid-speaker support parts are glued to their place. This way it is easy to install the speaker. I found the salvage on-off button, which will be used, and the support for the battery holder is also cut. So far this is how the speaker looks. From this upper view it is easier to see the vent and the mid-speaker chamber. The next step was to design a crossover circuit. To do this, the Exim freeware software was used. This is the circuit I came up with. The difference from the reality is that the mid and the tweeter will be on a single channel and the subwoofer will be on the other one. On the top you can see the subwoofer circuit consisting of an air coil and a 22 microfarad capacitor. In the middle the mid circuit is seen, only a resistor limits the output power. On the bottom the tweeter circuit can be seen, two resistors and a capacitor is used to get the desired cutoff frequency. On the right the frequency response plot can be seen, broken down to every speaker. The red is the subwoofer, the yellow is the mid and the black is the tweeter. The blue line is the system, in other words the sum of the three speakers. I've tested this crossover circuit on a breadboard and the result was really good, so I started to make the final PCB. After drawing the roots on the board, I made the holes for the components using an electric drill. Before the next step, the components had to be tested if they fit well on the board. Every component should be placed on the board to see if everything was planned correctly. In the next step, I've used masking tape and nail polish. With the masking tape, the whole board was covered. When it was done, I redrew the traces with the marker. Using a cutter, the traces are cut out, leaving masking tape only in the spaces between them. The next step was to paint the traces with nail polish and taking care to cover evenly everywhere. After letting the nail polish to dry, the masking tape was removed. The nail polish traces must be inspected carefully and repaired if necessary before the next step. The ferric chloride bath comes. I can't tell the exact time needed for the circuit to be etched correctly. When you do it, you have to check it yourself and see when it is ready. This board needed around 50 minutes of ferric chloride bath. The etching process can be accelerated by moving in circles and agitating it. By the way, it is highly recommended to use gloves and safety goggles. Moreover, try to do the etching process in a well-ventilated area. When you want to check the board, try to use a plastic tool. The ferric chloride has no effect on the plastic. When the board is ready, just use nail polish cleaner to clean the board and the drill bit to clean the holes also. When the board was clean, the components were soldered to their place. The coil for the subwoofer filter circuit is almost as big as the whole circuit board. The next step was to somehow fix this crossover to its place, which was a real challenge because of its size, but eventually it got to its place. The coil had to be fixed separately, but also I had to take into consideration that it must be fixed in a way that it should be removable if it needs to be repaired or changed. I started to fix the modules to their place. When I was designing the speaker, I wanted to make it to be easy to repair. As you can see, everything was designed to be modular, so if something is broken, I can just easily change the faulty module. The battery charge indicator was soldered and tested. This is how it looks. You can find the link for this product in the description. The front panel was a little bit hard to make. I had to drill holes and cut them to shape with jigsaw. I've used the file to make the holes perfect for the front panel components. The Bluetooth receiver module's status indicator LED had to be desoldered so I could make an extension to the front panel, and this way the state of the Bluetooth receiver can be seen. The front panel aluminum decoration piece is also done, which has a hole for a micro USB, two status indicator LED hole, and on the left a hole for the battery indicator button. Similarly to the front panel, this was made by drilling holes and the micro USB shape was created by using files. I've cut out an aluminum part which will hold the push button mechanism. The button itself is just the protector cap of a dusting cable. The Bluetooth receiver module status indicator LED support was cut from a small strip per K-piece and glued to its place. The LED will be just pushed in that support part. The assembly of the front panel was finished and I've taken it apart again to paint it. I've used glossy black paint because this was the only small quantity paint in stock and the result on the front panel was really promising, so I started to paint the whole speaker enclosure. It needed at least 2 layers to make a really good coverage, and between the layers I had to wait 24 hours, so the whole painting process took me about 4-5 days. When the painting was finished, the last step was to assemble everything and test the speaker. I would like to note that I was using my phone to record these footages, and the sound quality can also depend on your speaker system on which you are listening this video. This speaker is just a personal project and it is far from being a high fidelity speaker, but it is open for more improvements. I've practiced more with the XSIM and made better versions of the crossover, which I might test later. This is a design in which each speaker has a narrower frequency range, but the frequency response is far better. On this one the speakers are overlapping each other, resulting in a higher SPL but less fidelity. The original crossover has a dip in the 1.7 kHz region and the high frequencies are too high, as you can see on the impedance plot. This is the improved version, which just requires only a few changes compared to the original design. The aim is to make a crossover where the frequency response is more stable and achieve an almost perfectly straight blue line. I'm just learning to design speaker enclosures and circuits, so let me know in the comments where should I make improvements to the speaker. I would like to say thanks to Viktor Zorin for the first donation I have received. You can help this channel by donating, you can find the link in the description. Thank you for watching.